Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to the Pokémon North American International Championships. I'm Josue Crimson-Rojano, here with Kyle Stablehouse. Kyle, you just had the opportunity to commentate on the very first International Championship match of the weekend. What did you think of the match?
That was amazing. I love seeing the juniors going at it, and Reagan was able to come out and be our junior division international champion here for North America. Both players played fantastically. We had a three-game series. We got to see a lot of back-and-forth action, and I'm hoping that the seniors can do the same thing for us here.
Yeah, no kidding. It's a tall order, but I'm sure that they're up for the task. I am incredibly excited to keep commentating on this. I know that the juniors brought it. I'm sure the seniors are going to bring it as well. And then don't forget, guys, we will have the Masters right after that, followed by the Video Game Championships. Plenty of action to come. This is only the beginning of the final day of the North American International Championships. I believe we already are prepared with the senior division players. So let's get on stage with these introductions.
Thanks, guys. It is my privilege to introduce you to your senior division finalists. I'm so excited to watch them face off. Let's hear it for both of them. They are both representing Canada. It's Michael Long and Rowan Stavenow. They have a huge cheering section out here already, casters, and I'm so excited to watch them face off. You guys can take your positions. Good luck.
Thank you, Anna, for that. It is an honor to be able to commentate a match between these two players who are actually incredibly accomplished themselves. Both of them have actually, in their very short span within the Pokemon trading card game, have accomplished a great deal. Michael Long is actually already an international champion. He's the Oceania International Champion.
Yeah, and what an amazing accomplishment. That also means that he's willing to travel out to all these events, and that's fantastic. I love to see that already in the senior division, we have players that are that committed to the game and able to find that much success. That's also a lot of prize money coming his way, too, if he's able to find the table twice now for the championship.
No kidding. His college tuition will be well paid for in the span of 1 year. He has actually been playing for 3 years, and he's qualified for Worlds in all 3 years. That's a really great accomplishment, as well as having top-8ed all three international championships as of this point. But Rowan Stavenow is the very first player who we're going to be announcing, and that is the player on the left. Rowan is actually somebody who I've had the pleasure of commentating a match for before, as he is a world champion from 2015.
Yeah, what an accomplishment for him there. And he didn't stop also. He's got next, the following year, he was able to top four regionals and top four the national championships, which this tournament formerly was. Now, not stopping, continues on here at our North American International Championships.
What I love about Rowan is that when I was speaking to him, he was very humble. He was saying, you know, in 2015, I was the junior world champion, but then I aged up and I actually had very mild success. For him, mild success is a top four in nationals and top four in regionals, which to many, many players would be just an incredible accomplishment right then and there.
I want some mild success.
But here he is in 2017 with the opportunity to become one of the international champions in his division. However, Michael Long is going to be the player on our right here. And Michael is actually somebody who plays with Rowan quite a bit, as they're not from the same team, so to speak, but they live so close to each other that they attend each other's league challenges even.
Well, that might add an extra twist here. If both players are so familiar with each other already, we might be able to see that laid-back game style where both players feel comfortable and confident, and they're able to not let the nerves get to them. This might just feel like a League Cup to them. They're probably used to this.
Yeah, no kidding. The big stage does provide a lot of nerves, right? But when you put the headset on, you get that white noise. It's very easy to get nervous. But look at these players. They're both so comfortable. They're both so ready to play. They seem even more comfortable than you and me.
Yeah, that's right. Well, going with the decks here, we got to see a sneak peek over at what Michael's playing. He's going to be playing the Greninja, which we just saw fall in the junior division. Curious to see if that happens again, or if he's going to be able to pull out the championship here playing against Zoroark.
Yeah, Michael is playing a deck that we've already seen this morning with the Greninja Break, like you said. However, this time he's playing against Zoroark and not Rainbow Road. That's right. A totally different matchup. And actually, I believe Greninja's even favored in this matchup. So a lot of people would probably believe that Michael is favored to be the international champion here, a two-time international champion to join Reagan there.
Yeah, we one of the matchups that Zoroark really worries about, a lot of fighting Pokemon, but Greninja definitely as well. Greninja just doesn't have those big one-hit attacks that Zoroark likes to copy, so curious to see how this matchup pans out for the players. Just got to see the prize cards, nothing too big on one side, but a piece of the Staryu line.
Oh, there's a Frogadier.
Yeah, that's not going to be good either.
Having one Frogadier is never great whenever it's prized. That's probably the most important Pokemon for you whenever you're looking through your prizes, as you want them to get multiples out through your attacks. However, I'm thinking the advantage is still going to the Greninja player.
Oh yeah, the Staryu also not that big a deal. He does play a 2-1 line, so he still is going to have access to that to bring energies back and continue to use these giant water shurikens throughout the game. And it's just so difficult for Zoroark to keep up with this, but we are underway.
Yeah, either way, we do see a handshake here, which means that the game is now underway. Michael Long against Rowan Stavenow for the international championship here in the senior division. Right away, Rowan does start to turn off with a Ultra Ball, discarding a double Colossus Energy and a Zoroark. Those are some pretty heavy, that's a pretty heavy commitment to that Ultra Ball.
Yeah, he already has one more double Colossus Energy in hand, so it looks like this turn probably is going to be either a filling of the bench, either by Bridget or a Professor Sycamore, just playing everything out and trying to be as aggressive as possible, because you have to put a lot of aggression on this Greninja player. They have so much hit points, and Zoroark has a hard time dealing that much damage.
Looks like the best target for the entire weekend for this Ultra Ball has been this Tapu Lele, and sure enough, this match is no different, as now Tapu Lele is searching with Wonder Tag for any supporter card inside of the deck. However, Rowan is taking this opportunity to look through his deck and see what cards might be prized at this point.
Yep.
I think of note is Professor Kukui, which is in his prizes. He only plays one of it, and it's one of his, you know, his Wonder Tag targets from time to time. It's interesting to see if that'll come into play here.
Yeah, that's one way for him to sneak extra damage onto these Greninjas. Perhaps Michael would feel comfortable at some point not being knocked out, and then Kukui can sneak up and surprise him. But that option's no longer available with it in the prizes. Rowan correctly identifies that the number one attacker here for this matchup is going to be Drampa. He needs to get Berserks off early and often.
Indeed, and that is a Dark Energy as well as a pass here from Rowan. Obviously, on his first turn going first, you don't really want to overextend. You don't want to play too many resources. There's no reason to. You don't want to get an attack going that early, since obviously you can't. However, Michael does have the opportunity to start going off now, so to speak. He's going to try to get as many Froakies into play as possible. And at this point, it's just you search your deck, you see how many Frogadiers are prized. It's only one, which is, you know, it's acceptable, I guess.
Yeah,
but
not the best.
You want to get a Frogadier in play on turn two. That's absolutely crucial in order for your success with this deck, period, in any matchup, really. And the Zoroark matchup is no different.
Yeah, no, one difference between the junior finalist list and Michael's list here is that Michael actually does not play the Talonflame, going with a more consistent approach to that Froakie start, not nearly as devastating, because it's kind of what he's looking to start with. Opening Bubble is one of the more familiar attacks of his deck. He likes to start out, try to buy himself some turns. One dangerous piece of this, though, however, is that this energy does provide Tapu Lele with a knockout if we find a double colorless energy and the bubble is Tails.
You're right about that. It's kind of risky, right? It's a commitment that you're willing to lose the water energy. That's not the biggest deal. But taking that prize there, being behind on Rowan's second turn is just not where you want to be. And having only one Froakie in play after that is obviously even worse.
Right now we see over on Michael's side has an Ultra Ball, a couple options at the supporter stage. May want to grab a third Froakie, but just really up to him. Yes, he's going to go for the bubble, though.
There is bubble, and that's heads. That heads does mean that the Tapu Lele is paralyzed here, and it will not be able to attack, which means, you know, advantage Michael here, because there's no real way for Rowan to get past his paralysis.
Yeah, the only option that he has available now is to stand in with the Zoroark and have a Float Stone enabled in order to retreat. Doesn't want to use Mind Jack because it wouldn't be a knockout here. So If he's able to find double colorless energy and the Floatstone off of this end of six, he could be in a fantastic spot here.
Indeed, that Magma Seeker base combined with a basic Pokemon to bench does put some damage counters on Rowan's field, which is exactly what he wants for his Drampa to be able to start dealing more and more damage. We need to see a double colorless energy, and we need to see a Floatstone.
I think we saw one, but not the other. I see the double colorless energy. He's been able to find those pretty much at will. I had to even discard one early in the game. So now he can probably set himself up a little more, just have the Drampa ready to go. Maybe set up to have an attack next turn into what likely would be a Frogadier.
And there we see the double colorless energy does become attached to the Zoroark. But that also tells us that there is definitely no Floatstone in his hand, as he's forced to just pass the turn. That paralysis ended up being very important here for Michael, as it allowed him a single turn here to start gaining some additional resources. Now, it looks like Michael had a couple of Frogadiers in his hand.
Yeah, this worked out really well for him. Unfortunately, he found two of them, so that just means one water duplicate
will
be able to hit. But it's not the end of the world for him. He's able to immediately place that down because he did have access to a Froakie.
Only gets a duplicate for one if he chooses to do so, which is still better than nothing, but not impressive for your second turn with an evolution.
Yeah, now, it does look a tad awkward to have Greninja and Greninja Break in your hand there. Doesn't want to throw those away, but at the same time, he plays triple Rescue Stretcher, so he's able to find those when he wants to. Looks like he likes to hold on to the supporter in his hand for next turn, having the Greninja available to him for an immediate evolution, and then just have the Greninja Break in his discard pile, which means a quick Rescue Stretcher in the following turn would be able to have that break ready to go.
But that is the water duplicate, which signals the end of Michael's turn. Looks through his deck multiple times, only finds that single Frogadier. And that puts Rowan in a position where if he can start taking some knockouts on these Frogadiers before they start swarming, he's going to be facing down only a couple of Frogadiers from Michael, with the exception of any additional Pokemon that he might start placing down in the future.
Yeah, Rowan able to find double Zoroark Break via Seeker for the end. A little more disruption. He saw Michael hold onto that hand, not play a supporter, though. So taking a little bit of a risk here, giving Michael access to more cards. But I love the foresight of last turn, playing that double colorless energy on the Zoroark, knowing that water duplicates is going to be happening next turn, means that the board will fill up. Even just one more Pokemon means that 70 damage Mind Jack is going to be a knockout. And that worked out fantastic for Rowan.
Yeah, the Frogadier having very low hit points is coming into play in this at this point. I think if I'm Rowan, I'm just going to be trying to spread my energies as much as I possibly can here. And sure enough, Rowan does agree as he places a dark energy onto the other Zoroark Break. I think you just want to make sure that you have additional attackers throughout the remainder of the game. In case your opponent just kind of explodes with multiple Greninjas the Greninja Breaks, then you're not going to just be suddenly surprised by the amount of damage that he deals, and you're going to be able to keep up with his momentum.
Yeah, having Dark Energy on that Zoroark Break means you have access to Foul Play. This game can get very interesting. If you're Foul Playing Shadow Stitching, you can just make sure that the Greninja doesn't have access to its giant Water Shuriken, the Greninja Break, that is. And both players can be in this awkward stage of just dealing 40 damage to each other or Moonlight Slashing, just not getting knockouts and maybe even having to three-shot each other because of the way the hit points works out on the Pokemon.
I'm gonna go back in.
And we see Michael Ultra Balling there, finds himself the Greninja, has a Dive Ball as well, so really able to add onto this board. Finds a Froakie, which means that Splash Energies are going to start to do a little more work here if he has the line, the evolution line, pieced out on his board, Froakie, Frogadier. That means that he's able to play down the entire line right back into play after a splash energy is used.
Yeah, now is when we start to see Michael start to really start fleshing his board out. Has two Greninjas in play, gets the Froakie into play for a potential Frogadier on the following turn and so forth. And once we see a couple of Greninja Breaks, that's when things really start to roll here for Michael. And that's obviously what he's aiming for and what he's hoping to see on his following turn. However, for the time being, he's still kind of far behind on this board when we were talking about how he should theoretically be favored in this matchup.
Yeah, this is where Magma Base really starts to hinder Michael. The 170 hit points that he would be looking to have on his Greninja break. Awkward when Berserk is going to be doing just enough damage now because of that 20 damage. So that Froakie might be getting knocked out in the future just because of that little extra damage that happened maybe 3 or 4 turns later.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I'm trying to see if he plays Rough Seas, but I don't believe he does.
Yeah, a lot of lists don't have room for that. He's playing so many ways to just make sure that his Pokemon come back into play, really never leave the board. So many ways to bring back Pokemon. He has a lot of disruption with a multiple N and Ace Trainer even. And he wants to search out a lot of Pokemon with Dive Balls, Ultra Balls, Level Balls even.
So it should actually be a factor here, as Drompa is just, it's a heavy hitter. It's huge. It's an incredibly heavy hitter with a 150 damage Berserk from time to time. Once your opponent has those 20 damage on it, you no longer miss the Professor Kukui that's in your prizes.
Right. Now, Michael, he did choose to use Moonlight Slash, just do 60 damage. Doesn't want to bounce that energy back up, obviously, wants to have that splash energy effect occur. And he also knows the importance of having that 60 damage there so that the 80 damage of a Moonlight Slash in the future could knock out this Zoroark break. The Shadow Stitching would have been nice to stop stand-in, potentially, but that extra damage seems like it's going to be more important. We see Rowan now with the N here, and he's able to find a Dark Energy for himself, so continues to build on this board.
That is a pretty heavy Dark Energy commitment at this point, though. There are 3 Dark Energies placed on Rowan's field, and he doesn't play an insane amount. There's a very limited supply of those. So.
Yeah, he's got 6, so we already see half of his Dark Energies in play here.
Yeah, so early in this game.
And this is that part of the game that we're talking about. He just is going to use Foul Play and Shadow Stitch there.
Yeah, Foul Play does just bring up deal 40 damage with Shadow Stitching, but obviously the more relevant part is that we're not going to be seeing some giant water shurikens.
Yeah, that's right. You want to stop those for as long as possible. We've even seen Zoroark players starting to use the Giratina promo, trying to just make sure that these Greninja breaks have an even harder time against this deck, just because the matchup can be difficult. But we see Rowan is putting himself in a pretty good spot, has multiple attackers ready to go, and Michael's in a spot where benching extra Pokemon means that Mind Jack is going to be taking some knockouts. That extra damage from the Team Magma's base is going to do some work here to set up Berserk. So just a weird spot for Michael to work his way out of here.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of surprised at how this matchup's been playing out. It doesn't seem like it's supposed to play out like this very often, but now that it is, it seems like Rowan is just kind of consistently on the offensive here, and Michael hasn't been able to pull off the kind of hand that you need to really take that offensive away from him, at least not by this stage of the game. And it's on Michael to kind of do that at this point.
Well, Michael is a man after my own heart. He had the Field Blower, just got rid of the stadium in play that was affecting him, did not take away that Choice Band, because that means a Floatstone can't come down on that Zoroark. He knows that Choice Band isn't going to affect him in this matchup, so making it stay on the Zoroark break is actually a fantastic high-level play that a lot of players don't think about.
Yeah, I could have chosen to take the Choice Band away from the Tapu Lele as well.
Yep, it makes more sense to leave it there in play and make sure that you don't have that Floatstone.
Right, I mean, what's he going to do, deal no extra damage to your Greninja? It's a perfect perfect card to keep in play there. Now, a Dive Ball will find Michael any water Pokemon in his deck. However, because his deck is, so thinned out, at this point it seems like the only real options are Froakie or Greninja Break.
Yeah, this is where having any more Froakie can be dangerous. Mind Jack is getting to those weird numbers that just start to work out for Rowan now. So Michael's probably just going to continue to build up this board. He has the Starmie available. The moment that he has Giant Water Shurikens available, you know that that's 120 damage a turn before attacks. So as soon as Zoroark breaks start to fall, we can see a lot of damage come down on the board.
Okay, and it looks like we only deal 60 damage and pass the turn. And now that's that fourth dark energy being committed to this board, third one to the Drompa, which means that if we have a Floatstone here from the Zoroark break, then we will be able to see a Drompa berserk the Greninja break for a knockout. Yep, does he find it? I think he did.
And that's going to work out great for him. He can either come in and take this big knockout, leave himself susceptible to one turn of Giant Shurikens, that might not be too bad. We also saw he drew into the Hex Maniac, which will provide a great effect for him in the future turns. So really now just has to make the decision, is it time to go in or is it time to continue these Shadow Stitches? And it looks like he's ready to take a big knockout.
There's that Drompa. It's been powered up since turn one, if you remember. That was the very first energy commitment that he had on the board. And finally, it comes out to play. Berserk does knock out this large Greninja break, and that's two prizes taken now for Rowan, as opposed to Michael Long's zero. So now Michael is definitely on the back foot, but more importantly, he has only a single Greninja break in play and a Froakie. Those are his only potential attackers. So we're absolutely going to need to see a flurry of Froakies and Frogadiers start to come into play.
Yeah, now he has a bunch in his hand, obviously, now because of that splash energy, but he didn't have any more evolution stages lined up on his bench, so just able to get a Frogadier down. That means we aren't going to see anything wild like double giant water shurikens happening here. Maybe just the solo one, but he has to decide where the best place to put this is. Also, finding that splash energy means that this Greninja break and all the other stages will come back to the hand again.
Looks like there's a teammate in Michael's hand as well. What I like about his deck is that there's a lot of recovery. There's two teammates and one ace trainer. This time around, he goes with the ace trainer for his supporter for the turn, which does give him six new cards, and Rowan only gets to draw three.
Yeah, Rowan is definitely going to be trying to find some more energy cards here. Just wants to make sure that he can have an attacker each time that he gets challenged by another Greninja. So already has the answer to this Greninja potentially with all the damage that he has available to him. But it's going to take a little bit of setting up.
Choice Band played onto the Frogadier on the bench. We need to start seeing some rescue stretchers here for Michael.
Yeah, he would love to see one more Froakie. Just start to work on getting multiple lines out. If he just has one Greninja break at a time, this deck really isn't doing what it wants to do. It wants to take big swings with basic water energy, remove these threats, and then you can attack and have the line come right back with that splash energy.
Yeah, you basically want to trade your stage two break for two prizes from your opponent's GX or EX Pokemon. And you just,
That's a Professor Kukui. That's a lot of damage.
Well, we said that he had the Professor Kukui in his prizes. It looks like he found it from one of his prizes, as now Rowan is going to be able to deal that 170 magical damage, and down goes that Greninja break. Because of that splash energy, it does come right back up, but it comes up to his hand and not into play, as now all we see for Michael here is a single Starmie and a Frogadier. That is the only two Pokemon in his entire field of play, and none of them can really deal any damage yet.
Yeah, that was the only way that he was going to be able to take a knockout that turn. I thought he was going to have to retreat, perhaps use a Shadow Stitch with his Zoroark break, try to set up the knockout for the coming turn, but the Professor Kukui there was able to take the perfect knockout, and now Michael's on the back foot. Won't even be able to get a Greninja break into play here, and if he doesn't have multiple Froakie, I don't know if he's going to be able to come back.
That Kukui was fresh from the prizes, too. That was a huge prize draw in here from Rowan. And now he's up three prizes to six. All he needs to do is knock out three more Pokemon. And Michael still has to knock out six prizes worth of Pokemon. Michael's actually coming really close to knocking out this Drompa, though. And obviously, it seems like the Drompa is going to be hitting the discard pile by the end of Michael's turn. But it's done its damage. It's done its work.
Yep, that Froakie going down into play. It's going to have to take 20 damage due to that base. In play, Rowan was able to find another stadium there after the field blower occurred. And that damage is going to be pretty important. We saw how the Kukui had to happen last time in order to hit that big damage. And now he's going to have that damage already available to him, not going to need that supporter, which is pretty difficult to find.
Indeed, that base does deal 20 damage to that Froakie there. And teammates will find Michael any two cards from his deck and put them into his hand because his opponent did take a prize. Did knock out a Pokemon on the previous turn.
Yep. The teammates here, this is going to get him two cards. Just has to figure out the right way to do this. Michael knows that probably gonna have to buy some time here. The Lysander is one way to do that, and Bubble is one way to do that too. You can
sure.
Theoretically, you could just bubble, just keep doing that, buy as many turns as possible.
It's gotta be so tempting to knock out this Drampa, no?
it's hard. I mean, you do, obviously, you got to take this Drampa knockout here, but I'm thinking for him in the future, for him to be able to find a way out of this, it's going to be hard for him.
I mean, he gets the Shadow Stitching here, which is pretty nice. It stops your opponent from being able to Roshan, stops him from being able to Wonder Tag with Tapu Lele, several things like that. Or he could choose to just kind of save the energy and bring it right back up to his hand because of Night Slash. But it looks like he's going with a Shadow Stitching, knocking out this Drampa finally, and taking his own first two prizes of the game. So now the game is getting a little bit closer here as we are 3-4 between Rowan and Michael Long in this very first game of the Senior Division.
Yeah, and seeing that Drampa fall means that Rowan's one-hit potential for those big knockouts, it's pretty much gone now. He used so many energy on that already. Mind Jack is only going to be maxed out at 70 damage here due to the fact that Michael doesn't have many Pokemon down, and we might just see the Shadow Stitching war that I was referring to earlier. Both players just are going to be in an awkward spot while they try to rebuild, and we'll see how the prizes start to fall afterwards.
Special Charge brings one of the Dark Double Colorless Energies for back into Rowan's deck, filling it with more important cards as the deck starts getting a little bit thinner.
Yep, definitely wants to see those, but
Sycamore draws him 7 cards here. What's he looking for specifically?
Well, would like to find a Drampa. That Rescue Stretcher is able to do that. That means he's able to get another Drampa on board, has a double colorless energy that he drew off of that wisely using the Special Charge there, and then able to draw right back into the double colorless. So he's able to bring that Drampa back, throw down the double colorless there, and it looked like he also had a Hex Maniac off that draw. So next turn, he'll be able to set up himself in a fairly good position where he might not have to worry about being knocked out.
And Zoroark does foul play, copying Shadow Stitching, mitigating the number of damage that Michael can deal on his own turn. And there's that Greninja break.
Just look at the size of Michael's hand, but he's just not able to do too much. He's really limited by the fact that he has to take that turn to evolve each time. He doesn't have a forest of giant water plants to accelerate all of this. So he has to go very slowly. And he's finally got that Greninja break back out, sees that the Lysander might be his best shot here, has the Jirachi, so he has Stardust available to him. He can remove that double colorless, and we already know that Rowan is running pretty low on those, already using a Special Charge and discarding one with a Sycamore.
Yeah, that was a huge play here by Michael. He does play the Stardust Jirachi and the Lysander combination in order to get rid of the double colorless energy from Rowan's Drampa.
Yeah, and this also means that he's going to be immune next turn. So this really helps Michael in buying time in order to set up his board. He's got the Frogadier down, which means that a Greninja can come down. And finally, we might be able to see 2 Greninja breaks for Michael.
Yeah, I mean, in the near future anyways.
Yeah.
And now, because the Jirachi has that kind of spell effect on it where it can't take any damage or any effects from attacks. At this point, you're going to want a Lysander here if you're Rowan?
Yeah, that would definitely be helpful for him. He's going to use Ultra Ball, get rid of a few cards. He's already got 3 Zoroarks in play, so throwing away the last piece of that 4-4 line is going to not hinder him too much here, and I don't think he really even wants anything. He just wants to get rid of these cards.
Absolutely. They're completely useless in this matchup at this point because, first of all, it's not like Zoroark is a very good attacker in this matchup. And combine it with the fact that he's already got 3 in play, there's no need whatsoever for these last 2. And if he can never see them again in this game, he'll definitely do
it. It'll be too soon, yeah.
Yeah.
We see the Oricorio. This is one card that doesn't do too much in this matchup just because Michael never lets his Pokemon hit the discard pile by use of the splash energies, the rescue stretchers, and whatnot. And also Super Rod too. So there's so many different cards in order to make sure that Oricorio can't do much of a spread. I think we only see three Pokemon total after such a long game already.
Zoroark seems to be rushing in, but instead, it did rush in and then immediately retreats. So Tapu Lele is now the new active Pokemon, and then a Hex Maniac does end Rowan's turn. Rowan obviously does not attack onto the into the Jirachi, which cannot be damaged. Now, Michael, what can he do to follow up that powerful turn from his previous turn? He has a single Greninja break. Like you said, he's been trying to get that second Greninja break for a while. But right now, he still hasn't been able to do so. And he's definitely hoping to be able to change that as of right now.
Yeah, one thing that he doesn't want to do is play one more bench Pokemon. That means that the Mind Jack does a lot more damage and leaves that Greninja break pretty vulnerable. So he's trying to find a way to continue to apply pressure, but it's really difficult when Hex Maniac has occurred. He could Shadow Stitch and prevent stand-in at least. Maybe Rowan doesn't have the energy to retreat, or maybe just doesn't want to use that energy to retreat right now, because we've seen him use so many already. So we'll see what his line is here. It looks like he might be doing that, though, putting the Greninja Breakout and leaving it a little vulnerable.
So because Greninja Break still has 110 hit points remaining, we're going to need to see a Kukui from the discard pile be played here, which means a Versus Seeker here from Rowan would be huge for him, as he'd be able to knock out this Greninja Break.
Yep, and it looks like Michael has plans of his own. He can do a lot of damage due to the Choice Band. He can Moonlight Slash and get 110 damage down. That means that just one giant Water Shuriken will be able to clean up this Tapu Lele. And Michael's just counting prize cards now. He's got four left, one Water Energy, and a Greninja Break, so long as he's not prevented from using his abilities, means two prize cards, and now he just needs to find two more.
So he was forced to actually just play an N here, which brings him to a three-card hand and Michael to a four-card hand. But he must not have had access to that Versus Seeker for that Kukui, which would have been huge. It would have been able to allow him to not only take another prize, but take that Greninja Break out of the out of play, and once again, like you said, stop him from from playing multiple Greninja Breaks in a single turn.
Yep, we see the stand-in effect, and he's just going to put some more damage onto the Greninja here.
A little bit more Shadow Stitching action. Stops him. Stops Michael from being able to Giant Water Shuriken. You see how methodical this match actually is. Whenever you're forced to use your Zoroark for minimal damage, but a pretty nice effect against a deck that wants to abuse its abilities as much as Michael's deck does, it turns into a more drawn-out game, as both of these players have a very small deck size at this point, and they're both trying to conserve as many resources as they can while not over-committing to the board, for example, in Michael's side, where he doesn't want to play that fourth bench Pokemon, for example.
Just Michael now looking through, trying to figure out what his best option is. He's not used to having all of his abilities stopped this often, and it's just been very awkward for him. Now just looking to Lysander.
Versus Seeker finds the Lysander. Lysander brings up a Drampa. And now it looks like we're going to be seeing a new Greninja break, as this one only has 20 damage on it.
Yeah, now if he had the energy, we could have seen Lysander onto the Zoroark break, and then using Stardust with the Jirachi, could have bought himself one more turn. Which
do we have two DCEs in the discard pile for Rowan, or just one?
I believe he's down to two now.
Well,
and
if he finds a DCE here, this would be nice for him. A double colorless energy would be huge for Rowan, as he'd be able to knock out this Greninja break. Otherwise, that 150 hit points remaining is just very difficult to overcome given this board state.
Yeah, and he's just staring down teammates, which doesn't do anything for him. He hasn't had a knockout happen on his side of the board, and he knows that Michael is trying to set up a big double knockout play here with the Drampa ready to be knocked out along with the Tapu Lele, as long as he has access to two water energies. And is not shadow stitched.
The best Rowan could do was just shadow stitching here. It's a very good play given the board state and given the fact that his hand cannot cooperate. He wants to stop his opponent from being able to take two easy prizes with a giant water shuriken onto the Drampa. And now that forces Michael to either have another Lysander, which he might not have access to, or he just won't be able to knock out this Drampa before it gets another turn to potentially attack.
And
shadow stitching just paying so many dividends in this part of the match. And Ursa Seeker does find that Lysander. That Lysander does bring out the Drampa, and well, it seems like it'll bring out the Drampa anyways. And he's just trying to avoid that 150 damage attack. But at this point, there's been so many shadow stitchings done by the Zoroark that the 150 damage attack might not even be necessary. There might just be enough damage dealt through Mind Jack plus Professor Kukui, for example. It is coming close, but there is that Lysander, brings up that Drampa. That Drampa will be knocked out, and that'll give Michael Long two more prizes. He now takes the prize lead as he was behind three prizes to 4-6.
Yeah, and it looks like Rowan just scooped up there.
Yeah, Rowan basically assumed that there was just going to be no way that he was going to be able to win after that Drampa got knocked out. And Michael Long does take the first game against Rowan, as we saw how Rowan had the advantage throughout pretty much half of the game, if not longer. And then once Michael did start settling in, all he needed to do was just start targeting down these Drampas, and there went almost all of Rowan's damage potential.
Yeah, it seems like there's a window that Rowan has to have very early in the game where he has to put on a lot of aggression. And if Michael is able to withstand that, the game starts to flip on its head. And Michael was able to do that. We saw it wasn't pretty for him, but he was able to get enough Greninja break into play to really start making some great plays. And normally he's not used to using Lysander so often to take his knockouts. He generally has free range, able to snipe whatever he wants with Giant Water Shuriken, but he found the way to do it, and he was able to take this first game.
The problem with the shadow stitching plan when you're the Zoroark player is that you have too many GX and EX Pokemon in your deck, and your opponent will take prizes eventually, and when he does, he takes two prizes every time he knocks out one of these large Pokemon, while for you to knock out these 170 hit point Greninja breaks, you only get one prize out of that. So you guys are kind of trading little small amounts of damage to each other, but he gets two prizes out of it and you get one.
Yeah, it's a lot of work, and it doesn't feel great when you put so much damage into a Pokemon, so many attacks, often it's two or three, and you just get one prize card. And you look over on the other side and say, "Wait, how did you already take four prizes? I'm almost out of the game, and I feel like we've been having a pretty good standoff."
That's the advantage that you have when you're a non-EX or GX player, like the Greninja Break deck is. I really like how this format is shaping up, Kyle. I think that between things like Garbodor, where you have to start thinking about your items a lot, between cards like Zoroark, which make you think about your bench size, and Oricorio makes you think about the Pokemon in your discard pile. All of these things combined, it makes it so difficult for somebody to win when they're just autopiloting. You need to actually have so many things going through your mind throughout the entire game that the better player does have a big advantage against somebody who's kind of just, playing it a little bit more casually. And I think that that's always great when it comes to a competitive game like the Pokemon Trading Card Game International Championships are.
Right. Sometimes what looks like the obvious play is actually not the right play because they're playing around some ideas. So both players we've already seen doing just that with some great lines here in the opening game. And I'm excited to see some more action from them.
Indeed they are. And Michael does take a mulligan here, which will give Rowan one additional card to start the game off. Rowan once again will be going first as he now gets to choose because he lost the previous game. But Rowan has a tall order ahead of him. He has to defeat what we consider to be a pretty bad matchup for him in two straight games.
Yeah, and that will be tough. Benefit of having one extra card might actually be pretty big. Now it's two.
Another mulligan.
This happens a lot with Greninja decks. They don't play many basic Pokemon. In fact, he's only playing seven. He has the Froakies, two Staryu, and a Jirachi. A lot of these Pokemon are really susceptible to early knockouts, too. The maximum hit points that he could ever start with is 16.
And he does find a Froakie this time around. So he will no longer mulligan, but that will be two additional cards drawn for Rowan before he starts his first turn of the game. So now it's up to these players to play their prizes and start playing this game.
Yep. They should be putting down the prizes first and then getting ready to grab the mulligans. So we'll see what Rowan has in his
there
prize cards.
Rowan first playing down his prizes right away. We see one Zoroark, and Tapu Lele. But that's fine. Like we said, he does not want multiple Zoroarks. He doesn't need four in this matchup by any means. And a Greninja break to go with a Greninja and that Jirachi that we actually saw have such a huge impact. But you know what the card that I actually most cared about in those prizes were?
What's that?
The single Lysander in Michael Long's deck is actually in his prizes right now. So he will not have access to Lysander until he starts taking his prizes. And remember, it's not like he takes his prizes early very often.
Yeah.
And actually, it wasn't even a Froakie start. It was a Staryu start from Michael here.
The Staryu start.
The Staryu start, indeed. And actually, an end here from Rowan will bring both players up to a new fresh hand of six, each of them, for each of them, because neither of them has obviously taken a prize in this first turn.
Yeah, that's right. Staryu is probably one of the scarier starts. It has very low hit points. Does have free retreat, however. So that is a benefit. There is another Staryu that is available to play. Not as good, has a retreat cost, but a little more hit points. So taking the risk. And on the other side, we just see Rowan Floatstone Energy pass.
Yeah, like we said, you never really want to overcommit on your first turn, but this doesn't even feel like him avoiding overcommitting. It feels like more like he just really didn't have too many options available to him right now. And Michael here has a level ball, and I think I even saw a dive ball to go with his hand. It was a pretty stacked hand.
Yeah, just looking through right now, seeing what all's prized. Lucky enough for him, I don't believe he had any Frogadier prized. But he isn't going to have access to that Jirachi, which it came out pretty clutch. It was able to buy him a turn, remove double colorless when that was clearly something that Rowan was struggling with. And now he's not going to have that ability to him.
Yep, sure enough, there is that dive ball to go with the with that level ball. Finds himself another Froakie, no doubt. And that's really what you want to get on your first turn, is multiple Froakies so that your opponent can't leave you without one to start your second turn, where you want to water duplicate as many Frogadiers into play as you can.
Yeah, it's inevitable that you're going to play into Mind Jack on the opening turns. You have to do it in order to get all those water duplicates. So has to get those Froakies down. Choosing what Pokemon to leave active this turn will be pretty important, though. Perhaps a Froakie bubbling with a splash energy would be an option for him that he will consider.
It depends on how much you care about your Staryu throughout the match, throughout the game. And it seems like you might be right. He definitely might be going for that Froakie bubble.
Yeah, he's
contemplating it.
He's even considering not playing down the Froakie because then he would avoid being Mind Jack knocked out. But instead, he's just going to say, you need a lot of cards in order to take a Froakie knockout. I don't care too much about my Staryu. You can have that, because I'd rather have these Froakies getting ready to go. I know they're going to be some Frogadiers and Greninjas very soon.
I do believe that Michael came to the right conclusion there. I don't think you want to avoid being Mind Jacked so much as you want to make sure that you have a turn two Frogadier. And looks like a Versaseeker for an N, as well as a Drampa being played onto the bench, is all that Rowan can muster up himself. And at least he does get to shuffle away Michael's hand. Michael's hand was, like I said earlier, just incredibly powerful. And he did have access to a turn two Frogadier. So I think Rowan kind of acknowledged that and just said, all right, let's just, you know, give you a new hand of six, and hopefully this time around it's not as good.
Yeah, that's right. Now Rowan's going to see six fresh cards. Able to find...
There's another dive ball for Michael, by the way, so he will have a turn two Frogadier. And Rowan, on the other hand, has a turn two Zoroark going first. Is, you know, it's always powerful at that point.
Yeah, he can take a knockout here, but the rest of his hand, he doesn't have any supporter. He's going to need help from his prize cards in order to do that. I saw cards like Hex Maniac, the Zoroark Break. He's got Choice Band and I believe a double colorless. And these cards aren't going to help him. So actually, Big Wheel is probably going to be his best line here.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. I think it's always tempting to take that prize, but when you have to rely so heavily on the top of your deck or the prize, at that point you kind of want to just play it safe and go for that Big Wheel and spin yourself up to a 10-card hand.
Michael ambitiously thinking that he's going to Righteous Edge, places the 20 damage. But no, he will be using that Big Wheel. You're going to need to find an N to stop these 10 cards that are going into Rowan's hand.
The mind game started at an early age, apparently. And Rowan does draw himself 10 cards before he passes the turn over to Michael. Michael right away plays that Frogadier.
Do we see a supporter in his hand? I don't think Michael's, I see one.
No, I don't think so, actually.
Yeah, Rowan's going to see 11 cards with the 10 in hand and draw for the turn. So definitely expect to see as nearly an explosive start as all of these Frogadiers that come down off the water duplicates on the other side of the board.
Water duplicating for three Frogadiers is huge. It's always great. But leaving Rowan with an 11 card hand to start his turn is not. And we saw that double colorless energy fanned to the top of the hand for Rowan. No doubt he's going to want to play it onto the Drampa and start knocking out these Frogadiers before they start swarming the Greninjas. But actually, it seems like he's going to want to go with the Mind Jack instead because of stand-in. He'll be able to just stand in with that Zoroark and avoid taking damage on his Drampa.
Yep, this would be a fairly early magma base. Generally, you like to have a few Pokemon down on your bench before you use that. But if he has to use it now, then so be it. He's going to try to set up his Berserk damage for the coming turns.
Magma base does come down, wants to find a basic Pokemon to go with that magma base. All he needs is one, really. Well, he'd like two, but...
That is so surprising. Out of 11 cards, he was only able to play energy, magma base, and then he had to end himself to find something better.
And he didn't even play the double colorless energy, which is the rare energy for you to find in your hand.
Yeah, this definitely... I'd like to see those cards one more time. How can you find 11 cards and just play that?
I guess he was looking for some Pokemon. He was
that just didn't work out.
Oranguru was a nice find there.
Yeah, able to find a target finally for that base now and
All right. Well, Zoroark does stand in and knocks out this Frogadier, so that is going to be the first prize of this game going to Rowan again. And Michael down to four Pokemon on his bench, three of them being Frogadiers, though, and the other one being a Greninja.
Yeah, and now Michael again, he's just eyeing up, is it worth playing Froakie? Do I even need to? It would take 20 damage because of this magma base, and I would just be fueling Mind Jacks as well. So do I want to make that a possible option for my opponent? And he's still thinking about it. It's a close call. But yep, he is going to play that down. It takes the 20 damage. And the rest of Michael's turn, it looks like he's got a few options ahead of him with Ultra Ball and Versus Seeker.
Tries to decide what to Ultra Ball away before he does play his end. And it looks like he settled on a Rescue Stretcher and a Water Energy. Likely looking for that Greninja break, potentially another Greninja.
Yeah, if he's able to get multiple Greninja out and not have a Greninja in the active position, you don't have to worry about a foul play copying your Shadow Stitching. And that means that you can have those giant Water Shurikens available to you. As long as you can get two of those along with your attack, or well, just one in a Moonlight Slash even, you'll be able to knock out the Zoroark break. And that would be huge for him. He'd be able to continue giant water Shurikens in the future, unless, of course, there was a Hex Maniac.
That end now gives Michael a one-card advantage as Rowan has taken a single prize now. But Rowan does get a new hand of five, and we know how Rowan's been struggling to get any real traction going.
Oh, and fantastic draws for Michael. I saw the splash energy come right into the hand, and this is the exact board you want to have for splash energy. Has a Froakie, Frogadier, Greninja's down, so every piece of the evolution line besides the break is available to him.
Very interesting board state now for Michael, as this is really what he's always been trying to do. He couldn't accomplish this game one, but game two, he seems to be rolling on all cylinders here. And Rowan is actually really on the back foot here, as that Zoroark break has already taken 60 damage. And
yep,
it's his only potential attacker right now besides the Drampa.
The Moonlight Slash is able to set up a future Moonlight Slash where the energy would have to come back. Doesn't want to bring the energy back just yet. Wants to have that splash energy effect go off, knowing that Mind Jack is a pretty easy knockout along with perhaps even a Berserk. So got to keep that energy on play on the field there.
I wonder if he has a Kukui available to him.
Well, he has the... there's no break in play, so the Mind Jack should be plenty. And the Lysander there is actually going to mean that he can take a Greninja off of the field without having to play into that splash energy. Meaning Michael needs to find rescue stretchers now to get those pieces back.
Yeah, I had a break on my mind, but you're absolutely right. There was no break in play, and the Lysander does still get played, though, because, once again, you just want to avoid those splash energies for the time being. Eventually, you're okay with having to fight through them, but right now, you just kind of want to whittle away at the Pokemon in Michael's side of play.
Yeah. Michael eyes up his discard pile, just seeing finally some Pokemon in there. He's not used to that.
And there is one Greninja break. Will we finally see two breaks in play?
Yep, there was no shadow stitching effect on the last turn, so we finally get to see some giant water shuriken action. One going there to the Drampo that had no damage on it. Three giant water shurikens would be able to seal up a knockout on that Drampo. Probably not happening this turn, but of course he's going to be trying to set up big swings in the future.
Yeah, indeed. And right now I think he's even content just knocking out the Zoroark break with the Moonlight Slash there.
Yeah.
So there's no real need to knock out the Drampa, but it's still nice to be able to have that access to that in the near future.
Yeah, and because Rowan did not deal with the Splash Energy last turn, this means that Michael has access to the basic water energy as the energy to pull up with the Moonlight Slash and gets to keep that splash energy on the board. So now Rowan's going to have to deal with it again.
This is really how this matchup seems like it's supposed to play out here. As once the Greninja player does have enough Greninjas in play, it just seems like the swarm of all these little ninjas just too much for a Zoroark to overcome, even though Zoroark does get extra damage from its Mind Jack going.
That's right. We see Ultra Ball, meaning another Greninja break coming into play.
There it is, the two Greninja break dream.
And this is where that Kukui comes into play that you were talking about now, because there's a lot of hit points on this Greninja. It was able to come into play without the secret base, of course, dealing any damage to it. So it's very difficult for Rowan to hit these numbers unless he has all the cards in his hand already.
Rowan really going to be hoping for a Kukui here, but at the same time, Michael is just taking his first prize of the game here, but additionally removing potentially the best attacker Rowan has on the field right now.
And just look at that. He was able to place 120 damage without his attack, and his attack removed the biggest potential threat on Rowan's side. Now it's Rowan's turn to answer, and he just has to promote the Drampa that already has taken so much damage. One slight thing that he can do now is he has Righteous Edge available to him if he wants. Not really dealing with anything, though, and I really would rather have a knockout.
He has the Sycamore here, which means that Greninja Break will not be knocked out. Just nothing really going Rowan's way in this game, or this match, really.
Yep, finds a double colorless energy, able to start setting up the Drampa on the bench here. Meaning likely we will see the Righteous Edge. That means that he won't have to have the Professor Kukui in the following turn to knock out this Greninja.
These two Canadian rivals going at it on the biggest stage that Pokemon has really seen. And it shows where the 2015 Junior World Champion is honestly just maybe a turn away from being eliminated here by Michael Long, who is already a one-time Oceania International Champion, potentially about to become a two-time International Champion in just a single season. Unprecedented, really, and only, once again, only Reagan Rotzloff has been able to pull that off.
Yeah, a big snipe here with the giant water shuriken, able to take those two prize cards. We see Rescue Stretcher immediately getting back that Frogadier. And Michael has everything on his side now, even holding on to a teammate's if that Drampa is able to answer the Greninja. But does he have energies? I don't
Michael
see.
Michael has a Lysander here.
He would really like to have that Starmie that he plays.
Yeah, no kidding.
That would be able to pull up multiple energies, have two shurikens available to him, and be able to attack too.
Where are your dive balls at right now? Greninja Break does retreat here as it doesn't kind of want to... it looks like it retreats for the other Greninja Break, but it doesn't want to be just kind of vulnerable out there. And it looks like Michael's forced to pass.
Yep.
Really a big window here for Michael, and he is not able to really take advantage. And now we see a Zoroark come down. an Oranguru being the active Pokemon is never what you really want to see here, but at this point, Rowan is just kind of gripping onto any, you know, the basically his last few straws and trying to find out what he can do here.
Yeah, he would like to have a float stone.
A Sycamore draws him 7 cards.
Just hasn't been able to put all the damage together for himself and drawing pretty awkwardly, just finding a lot of supporters, not finding those cards in the right order for him. You know, he would like to find Kukui and Floatstone in this same turn to have a big swing. He just hasn't been able to have that turn. And this is scary for Rowan. Anytime that he benches a Zorua, he's giving a prize card to Michael if he has a water energy.
Ultra Ball discarding a Zorua. And one other card, still debating on it. Looks like it's going to be... Well, it looks like he does settle on his discards here, and Rowan will be finding any Pokemon from his deck that he'd like.
Yeah.
Finds a shame in here.
He threw away teammates. He knows that likely the turn that one Pokemon gets knocked out, that will be the end of the game. Michael will be able to take multiple knockouts in one turn with the use of the Water Shuriken. Rowan wisely not playing that Choice Band down on the Zoroark, would rather have a Floatstone there to have that stand-in and retreat available to him. And he's able to look through his deck, sees a lot of double colorless, the Floatstone available to him. The Kukui has been in the deck the entire time, just hasn't been able to find it at a good spot for him. And he's running out of options here.
Chooses not to find anything with that Wonder Tag. Kind of just wanted to play the Tapu Lele down so that he could draw an additional card with the Shaman. What exact cards is he looking for? Just a Floatstone, for example?
Yeah, that definitely would be helpful, but I don't think there's a combination that gets him out of this. Definitely not no knockout potential here, but he can maybe set himself up in a better spot for next turn with how much damage he can get on this break.
Yeah, he would definitely like to start doing something. At this point, the Greninjas can start getting just too far ahead with a giant water shuriken if he can find access to the water energies. So now it's on Michael. Can he find the Starmie? He finds a dive ball right away. That dive ball is going to be huge for him, as that's going to find him that Starmie, and that Starmie will find him the water energies he needs to be able to potentially seal this game. That was a giant top deck here for Michael.
Yep, Space Beacon is going to allow him to take these useless cards in his hand and turn them into 2 water energies, which means a 120 damage is now available for him. And he will be able to do this just about every turn now, unless, of course, a Zoroark Break comes into play. And he can just make sure that never happens again by removing the Zoroark right now if he wants, or he can start to position damage on these GX Pokemon in order to clean up the game next turn even.
He's got plenty of options available to him. He can always knock out the Zoroark and then on the following turn knock out the Shaman. Or on this turn, he looks like he might be going for the Shaman right away.
Yep, he can do the damage to the Shaman. If he draws a water energy, he can win the game with a
Bisander. He finds the water energy. It looks like he does not, though.
Yep.
Finds another Greninja Break. Not what you need to close out the game this turn. But Michael down to 1 card in hand. Or I'm sorry, down to 1 prize. Rowan, 4 prizes remaining. And, I mean, even if he ends his opponent here, Starmie is just going to be exactly what Michael needs. It seems like you need to foul play and shadow stitching your opponent here for seemingly forever.
Yeah, or even have that Hex Maniac available to you as well. But no, he's just going to have the end there. So we probably do have to see a Shadow Stitch, or you just...
Yeah, we absolutely need to see a Shadow Stitch, otherwise the game's over.
Yeah.
But at some point, we're going to need to see a Lysander to knock out the Starmie, and just cross your fingers that your opponent doesn't have access to water
energy.
Yeah,
maybe he never sees water energy the rest of the game. Who knows?
So it needs to be Shadow Stitching until you can stop your opponent from having access to that Starmie, and then you just cross your fingers for that single turn while you can't end him, you know, down to a 1 card hand, and hope that he doesn't have access to a water energy. And at that point, you can end him and hope that he just has no resources for the rest of the game. But those are really the only options he has available to him. But it seems like he does not do that.
Yep, and Rowan does take the prize, but that won't be enough. We're going to see the Space Beacon grabbing the water energies.
And that will be... I mean, that's just going to be a couple of giant water shurikens, no?
Yeah, he can go ahead and actually just knock out the active Pokemon if he chooses.
Yep, and that is the match. Michael Long wins 2-0 against Rowan here. And Rowan Stavenow did his best. He truly did, but the matchup was just too difficult to overcome as Michael Long is our two-time senior division international champion, winning both Oceania and the North American International Championships in the senior division.
Yeah.